So of Jesus and from Jesus, the book comes from Jesus, and Jesus is the one who is talking about the reality of the book. Because of the time span wasted, I cannot finish this presentation today, so I will divide it into two. The point must be made, ladies and gentlemen. If you read Revelation 1 verse 19, the Bible says, write the things which you have seen, and the things which are, and the things which will take place after these things. In these, there are three folds to the book of Revelation. I call it the BBF. Revelation deals with the past. Revelation deals with the present. Revelation deals with the future. The BBF. Because the Bible says carefully, if you read it so carefully, in Revelation 1 verse 19, it says, write the things which you have seen and the things which are. You see, the scene is in the past tense. It's not something present. So John was instructed to write the things which had already he had seen in the past tense, the things which are in the present tense, and the things which will be or will take place after this thing. The book of Revelation is in threefold. It deals with the past, it deals with the present, and it deals with the future. Will somebody say an amen there?
Amen.
The book of Revelation have some five amazing W's that you've got to go home and understand what the five W's are. Who wrote the book of Revelation? John, the beloved disciple of Jesus, who was the youngest among the disciples, the author of the Gospel of John, the author of the John's first John, second John, third John. He is or was the author of the book of Revelation. Will somebody say an amen there?
Amen.
The book of Revelation have the second W. What was it written for? It's a written record of messages, of prophecies, and visions that John personally saw and heard. So these are eyewitness account. From Revelation chapter 1 to Revelation chapter 22, they deal with an eyewitness, somebody who was there when the things took place. They tried to kill John, but God used a moment of crucible, a moment of pain, a moment of perplexity, a moment of discouragement. God used that to make the case that no matter circumstances we may go through, if he, God, is in charge, just as he did to John, the most compelling revelation of Jesus happened when John was going through his crucible. By extension, revelation is in existence to comfort all who are going through pain, all who are going through frustration, all who are going through perplexity, all who are going through an abuse or an intimidation. If you are here under the sound of our voice, listening in the comfort of your home, wherever, the Bible or the book of Revelation gives the assurance that it will be well in Jesus' name. There is another W to the book of Revelation. We deal with the who. We dealt with the what. What message is it? It's a message of the book of the revelation of Jesus. The revelation of Jesus, which involved vision, involved prophecy, involved scenes that John has seen. But when this book was written, somewhere in AD 95 or AD 96, making Revelation one of the last books of the Bibles to be written, the book of Revelation. Why was it written? It was written to show believers throughout the century the things which would take place in the end of time. If you study it carefully, this is what Jesus says. Revelation chapter 1 verse verse 1. He says, the revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave him to show his servant things which must shortly take place. Revelation is very important to study because they deal with things which will soon take place. It deals with things of the last day. Last day event is in the book of Revelation. As I indicated, I said yesterday, we are in the end of time. We are in a time of abuse, a time of brutality, a time of cruelty, a time of deception, a time of emptiness, a time of gruesomeness. The times in which we live, we are at the realm, or we are just at the end of the world. This is why we need the study on the book of Revelation. My brothers and sisters, this book has got some seven beatitudes, or some call it the beatitude. The book of Revelation has some seven blessings. Anyone who looks at this book this night, I want God to confer these blessings on you. In Revelation chapter 1 verse 3, blessed is the man or the woman, the Bible says, who reads, who hears, who heeds the prophecy of this book. You are blessed tonight for being able to read, for being able to hear. And if you heed to the words of this book, you are blessed. Will you say an amen there?
Amen.
The second blessing in the book of Revelation is, blessed is the man who died in the Lord. Revelation 14 verse 13 says, they will rest from their labors and they will receive their reward. If you are a man, you are a woman, and you understand the biblical insight of the book of Revelation, whether you die, whether you are alive, the Bible says you are blessed. The book of Revelation has instead blessing. Blessed is the man or woman who stay alert and keep their clothes. I'm referring to Revelation chapter 16, verse 15. They will not be ashamed and they will not lack their reward. Any man who reads the book of Revelation will be alert because it deals with end time event. The book of Revelation will prepare you. The book of Revelation will stir you. In many churches today, people are dead. People are asleep. People are careless. People are reckless because the book that deals with end time event is not taught, it's not preached, it's not discussed. So church members go to church, they speak in tongues, they go to church, they dance, they go to church, they give offering, but they don't know the times in which they are, so that they'll be alert. The book of Revelation will give you the privilege as a Christian, as a believer, as an African, as a Nigerian, you want to live above the crowd. Welcome on board. The third blessing in the book of Revelation is to keep you watching until the world comes to an end. The fourth blessing that the book of Revelation presents is in Revelation 19 verse 9. Blessed is the man or woman, those who are invited to the wedding feast of Christ. They will experience eternal, everlasting celebration. The Bible says in Revelation 19 verse 9 that you are blessed if you study this book, if you understand its word. You will be able one day in a place called heaven, one day in a street made of gold. You can't walk, you can't talk, you can't move with Jesus, and most importantly, you will eat with him. Will somebody not say an amen here?
Amen.
I'm talking about the book of Revelation. The book of Revelation, it says that blessed is the man or the woman who have a part in the first resurrection. I'm referring to Revelation chapter 20, verse 6. They will never suffer or die the second death. My brothers and sisters, the sixth blessing in the book of Revelation is, blessed is the man or woman who heed the words of the prophecy of this book. You listen to the statement in the book of Revelation. You are willing to follow the things in the book of Revelation. Revelation 22 3 verse 7 says, they will be ready for the second coming of Jesus. And the seventh blessing is, blessed is the man, Revelation 22 verse 14, who wash their robes, they will receive reward for their deed. These are the seven beatitudes in the book of Revelation. I'm talking about the untold truth, about the truth. In other words, the book of Revelation explains that it comes from the Trinity. In fact, Jesus epitomizes God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. Jesus is, he embodies the Trinity. So you look carefully at the book of Revelation. Revelation chapter 1 verse 4, he says it's a divine message. The revelation of Christ, which God gave him. So it is a divine message. So the message came from God the Father, who himself gave. So he said it is a revelation of Jesus, which comes from God. So God the Father is the originator of the book of Revelation. Not just that, Jesus bore this message. So Christ was involved. The Holy Spirit, we are told in Revelation 1 verse 4, that he was given, the message was given to the seven spirits which are before the throne of God. So you have God the Father, you have the Holy Spirit involved, and you have Jesus himself as the central person who sent forth issues in the book of Revelation. Christ, and from Christ. So we can say, just like the spiritual gift in the book of Ephesians chapter 4, the book of Revelation comes also from God the Father, comes also from God the Son, and comes also from God the Holy Spirit. Will somebody say an amen there? Amen. With this background, with this in mind, the book of Revelation have in these last days given us a clearer view that God is interested to speak to us through his Son. Because when you look at Revelation 1 verse 1, it says it's the revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave him to show to his servant things which must come to pass. So Jesus is an active ingredient in showing us the meaning of the book of Revelation. And that is buttressed in the book of Hebrews, chapter 1, verse 2, that God has in these last days spoken to us through who? His Son. Therefore, if the book of Revelation deals with last day event, if the Bible says in Hebrews 1 verse 2 that Jesus will speak to us in these last days, it therefore means if you extrapolate, you can then conclude to say Jesus will speak to this end time generation through the book of Revelation. When we talk about Jesus, we are talking about Yeshua. We are talking about Isa al-Messiah. We are talking about the one who is God's begotten Son. They are told truth about truth. You see, Jesus was on earth. He demonstrated, he seen or reveals a lamb-like Savior. Jesus revealed himself as a lamb-like Savior. As a servant, or at best, he was a slave leader. So you see him helping those who are in immorality, helping those who are distressed, helping those who have lost their sight, helping those who are into shady deals, helping those with physical needs and physical hunger, helping those who are into very addictive moral behaviors. In fact, helping teachers of the law. You see, Jesus exhibited this. In fact, you look at his birth, it was very humble. So, persons throughout centuries feel that this is all that Jesus is about. Even if you read the book of Philippians, chapter 2, verse 6, talking about Jesus, Paul said, who being in the form, in other words, who being God, he did not consider it robbery to be equal with God. That shows the humility of Jesus, but made himself of no reputation, taking the form of a bonded servant. So you see Jesus, that is what Isaiah said in Isaiah chapter 53, that who will believe our report, and to whom is the arm of God revealed? When you look at Jesus, there is nothing that shows that he is God. So that is how he lived. He died. But the book of Revelation presents Jesus not as a servant, not as just a lamb. It presents him in the form of a God. Will somebody say an amen there? Yeah. Did I say a form? He presents him as the God. The untold truth. The book of Revelation reveals what we never know about the divinity of Jesus. Ladies and gentlemen, how do I know? You study the book carefully. Revelation is saying Jesus is not just a good rabbi, but he is God. The book of Revelation makes it so plain. Revelation 1 verse 8, he says, I am the Alpha, I am the Omega, I am the beginning, I am the end, says the Lord, who is, who was, and who is to come, my BPF God, the God of the past, the God of the present, and the God of the future. Will somebody not say an amen there? Revelation says, you want to see God? Here he is. He is the beginning of your life, the beginning of existence, the beginning of beginning. Jesus is not just a baby born in a manger. He is God. He is the beginning. If there is anything called beginning, Jesus is that beginning. I love the way John put it in John 1, Revelation 1, verse 11. He says, say, I am again the Alpha. I am the Omega. I am the first. I am the last. And what you have seen, Jesus is the one speaking, so he is finished speaking. He said, John, hey, I am the first, I am the last, I am the Alpha, I am the Omega. Now, write these things and send to the churches. Jesus is portrayed in the book of Revelation as God. My brothers and sisters, in Revelation 22, verse 13, he said of Jesus again, I am the Alpha, I am the Omega. Now tonight, this is what I want you to take home. If ever you begin anything in your life, and he's not part, it will fail. If you end anything in your life, if life begins minus Jesus, it is life of futility. If life ends minus Jesus, it will end in futility. If your business begins without Jesus, it will end in futility. If your business ends without Jesus, your academics, your marriage, your relationship, ladies and gentlemen, the Alpha and the Omega is calling on you this night. He says, do you want to succeed? I am God. I will begin with you. I am God. I will end with you. I am God. I will be your Alpha. I will be your Omega. Will somebody not say an amen there? Yeah. What a mighty God we serve. Revelation 21, verse 6. Jesus is making a statement. If you read the gospel, you are watching Jesus in a black and white TV. You read Revelation, his world coming. I am the Alpha Nigeria. It doesn't reside in Buhari. It doesn't reside in Jonathan. It doesn't reside in Obasanjo. It doesn't reside in any leader. Nigeria, do you want to succeed? Behold the Alpha. Behold the Omega. Behold the beginning. Behold the end. Will somebody not say an amen there? The Old Testament bore record. How do I know that statement, Alpha and Omega, indicate that Jesus is saying that I am God? Isaiah chapter 44, verse 6, it says, that says the Lord, the King of Israel, and his Redeemer, the Lord of hosts, I am the first, and I am the last. And beside me, there is no hope. God. This is an indication that when the book of Revelation says that Jesus is saying, I am the Alpha, he said it 7 times. I am the Alpha. I am the Omega. He is emphasizing in the book of Revelation, we will get to know tomorrow and subsequently, the number 7 indicate completes. God will say, I am a complete God. Don't come to me in the day and in the night. You look for a night insurance policy. You come to church in the day and in the night you go to occultic powers. Jesus said no. In the book of Isaiah chapter 48 verse 12, he said, hearken unto me, oh Jacob, you can replace it with your name, and Israel, you are my called. I am the first. Nigeria, Jesus says, make me number one. He says, make me the first and make me the last. The prophet Isaiah emphasizes, you know, the book of Isaiah deals with the messianic mission of Jesus. In Isaiah 46 verse 9 to 10, it says, and from ancient of days, things that are yet to come. And he says, for I am God, and there is no other. I am God, and there is none like me. I declare from the Omega up to the Alpha. I declare from the end to the beginning, Jesus is indirectly saying and re-emphasizing, I am not the baby Jesus that was born in a manger. I came in that manner so that I can save you. When John, remember, John was the youngest disciple of Jesus. Jesus had left about some 60, 70 years. So John, about some 30, 80 years. So John, hey, I have seen him. I want to believe by the eye of faith. Tears were in the eyes of John. So John says, and I dare. He want to see. I know this voice. The voice that healed the sick. The voice that provided food. The voice that secured labor. Yeah. I want to see who is this. And he says, the voice that was speaking to me, when I turned, I saw 7 golden lampstands. And in the midst of the lampstand, one like the Son of Man. He says, clothed in a robe. It's not just God. He doesn't know what God looks like. This is the Jesus I know. Bear in mind, when Jesus came to die for us, he perpetually took our form. He can never change anymore. So John says, I have seen in the entire Bible, only one person is referred to as the Son of God. He says the Son of Man, the Son of Man, clothed in a robe, reaching to the feet and guarded across his breast with a golden girdle, and his hair were white like wool. John says white
like wool. And said, no, they were like snow. And his eyes were like a flaming fire. And his feet were like a burning bronze when it had been caused to glow in a furnace. And his voice was like the sound of many waters. And you keep reading, he says, and his right hand, he held the seven stars. And out of his mouth came a sharp two-edged sword. And his face was like the sun shining in its light. John, he saw God, Jesus, no more as a man nailed on the cross. He saw him in his glorified form. He was out. He was surprised when he saw it. The Bible says, when I saw him, I fell.